When life seems full of clouds and rain, and I'm full of nothing but pain, who soothes my thumping, bumping brain? Nobody. When wintertime comes with its snow and sleet, and me with hunger and cold feet, who says, here's 2 bits, go and eat? Nobody. Well, I ain't never done nothing to nobody. I ain't ever got nothing from nobody. No time, and until I get something from somebody, sometime I don't intend to do nothing for nobody. No time.
Shut the fuck up. No one cares about your robot fan fiction. Know your fucking place, trash. Fucking robots. I don't give a fuck about no robots. They ain't got no soul.
Yeah, I have no excuses. We're nearing a full year since the release of, well, you know. And now that's all said and done, all the hype is long since buried, and the glorified participation trophies have all been distributed, let's talk about Last of Us 2 one more time. Because what would be the point of a trilogy without a shameless hollow attempt at a reboot? In all seriousness, it's still shocking seeing a game like this get as much praise as it did. Despite all the controversies, such as Naughty Dog abusing DMCA law to take down leaked material, even going so far as to strike people just talking about the leaks. Also, the crunch. Yeah, the crunch culture at Naughty Dog was so bad there were rumors about exiting employees being threatened into not saying anything in order to receive final paychecks. And it all amounted into a pretentious dreck of misery porn that fans of the first game absolutely despised. You've heard this countless times already. Everybody knows the game was divisive, to say the least. The words I'd use are retarded, stupid, overrated, shallow, tone deaf, and so on. Not exactly a fan of Last of Us 2, if it's not obvious. Now, to get it out of the way, I did enjoy the first game. It was a compelling story about survival and purpose in a bleak world. The characters felt natural and authentic, the subject matter was handled very maturely, and it was universally praised by both audiences and critics. So when the sequel was announced, it got some serious attention on it. Fans were excited to see the next chapter of this franchise, especially when it was confirmed Joel and Ellie were coming back. Personally, I always thought that was a sign of something bad because their stories were pretty much over at the end of the first game, but then the leaks happened and the game happened.
You're drunk!
I'm not drunk, I'm angry, I realize that. I'll calm down. No, calm down! I lost my daughter today! And I did everything right! I hope they take my house, and I really have nothing. I hope I get hit by a truck full of fucking cement.
Last of Us 2 is a very special game. It was completely convinced that it was an unfiltered exploration of humanity's evil. A no-bullshit story about loss, revenge, insanity, and grief. But in reality, it's not exactly as well thought out as it likes to think it is. In fact, this is one of the preachiest, hollow stories that I've ever seen. Casinos with bright neon signs have more restraint and subtlety than this supposed greatest game of all time. Now, I've made 3 entire videos about this game, one of which is an hour long, but I can't help but think each time I made those videos that I wouldn't strike at the exact heart of my problems with this story. There would be complaints and explanations on why things didn't make sense, but it still feels like there's some ground to cover. Recently, I found myself falling back into the rabbit hole of Last of Us 2, watching videos that go over the controversies and the story. It was just last year, but it feels like a lifetime ago. It's fucking nuts. Still, now that there's been plenty of time to digest everything that happened and get our minds away from this forgotten trash heap, I think I finally know why this story pisses me off as much as it did. Last of Us 2 has no consistency to it. Like, at all. Now, everybody knows about the joke about mathemes. Revenge is bad, and you will hear this for 30 hours until you understand. But beyond that, the morality of this game is all over the place. When you really tear down the structure of Last of Us 2 and examine everything, you just see how empty the lesson is. Last of Us 2 wants to examine human evil, but it seems either unwilling or absolutely terrified of delving deep into those depths. Sure, there's plenty of surface-level edgelord shit, torture, gore porn, miserable people screaming at each other. Last of Us 2 looks grim and dark, but to truly sink into dark territory requires way more than just seeing people get shot. To say that Last of Us 2 is as dark as it wants to be is like saying Friday the 13th is on the same level as The Road. No. They're completely different experiences that use different elements. Now, the first game does this perfectly well. It's an unforgiving journey, to say the least. However, there was a science to Last of Us 1. While what Joel and Ellie go through is nightmarish, the actual development between the two is extremely hopeful. They grow to truly love one another, and Joel finally finds a chance to be a father again. Even with the pain and suffering, there was a light at the end of the tunnel. Almost like that was the theme of the game. Last of Us 2 has a different philosophy. Instead of being a story of redemption and hope in a cruel world, the sequel wanted to explore harsher ideas, namely things such as hatred and vengeance. Now, on paper, I'm absolutely on board with this idea. I love dark stories, and a good revenge story can be downright legendary.
No fue personal. Para mí sí.
But as we know, Last of Us 2 is not a good revenge story. I'm not gonna bother with a full summary of the plot. We all know what the story is, and there's already countless videos dissecting everything wrong with the plot at large. I don't want to talk about the full story here. Instead, I want to talk about how a few major elements fucked everything to pieces. This will involve spoilers, so if you haven't played the game and want to check it out for whatever reason, be warned. There's something even fans of the game agree is a major mistake with the story, and that is the structure. The structure of the game is just a mess, to say the least. You start the game as Joel for a few minutes, then jump to Ellie living in Jackson, then it jumps to Abby making her way to Jackson, then jump to Ellie living in Jackson, then it jumps to Abby making her way to Jackson, then jump to Ellie living in Jackson. Then we cut back to Ellie after the death of Joel, and from there we stick with her until the events of the theater, where we switch to Abby's perspective and explain how she got there, and the whole context behind what she did and why. It's not great. The beginning has us constantly jumping perspective, so it's really hard to get used to sitting in one person's shoes. Now, I've heard an interesting interpretation for why you'd play as Joel in the beginning. It's a dark way of foreshadowing his death, since we played as Sarah in the beginning of the first game before she dies. Not gonna lie, if that was intentional, that is a good detail, yes. But having us go from Joel to Ellie to Abby, then back to Ellie, feels needlessly convoluted. It could have easily went from Joel spending time with Ellie and almost setting him up to be the protagonist again, to then playing as Abby and doing everything there, and then going to Ellie, and would have felt way more natural. This is just a personal gripe though, there's way more problems than just this. So the problem with having you switch to Abby at the midpoint of the game is that it grinds the pacing to a halt, especially since Abby's campaign is almost totally unrelated to Ellie's shenanigans. On top of that, the player hates Abby for what she did. There's no ifs, ands, or buts, they hate her. You set her up as the villain of the story, she kills the protagonist of the last game. So smash cutting to the player having to do a glorified side quest, playing as somebody they despise, right at the climax of the story, is just a disastrous move. Now, if they swap back and forth between Ellie and Abby, sort of how Yakuza 0 paced everything, then it would have been way more tolerable. People would still hate Abby, but it would better point to what you were going for. Instead of being stuck playing as Abby for 10 hours in a completely unrelated series of events, you would be jumping between the two perspectives, and keeping the engagement high. Sure, maybe players wouldn't give a fuck about Abby's arc, but it's just every other chapter. Just an hour or two with this, and you can go back to playing as Ellie. Oh, they're clearly setting something up here is what would be said instead of, I seriously don't give a fuck about what androgynous She-Hulk has to say, she can get fucked by a sea urchin for all I care. You'd absolutely still see Abby death montages on YouTube, but that's the nature of these kinds of story decisions, you're going to piss somebody off. But the biggest problem is that Abby's campaign feels completely unrelated to everything at large. I can see what it's going for. It wants to set up contrasting character arcs between Abby and Ellie. One is turning more monstrous and hateful, while the other is slowly redeeming themselves. If done right, this could have been a very interesting way of going about the story. However,
please stop! Please don't shoot! Joel, please get up!
This is where that lack of stable morality comes into play. A common criticism that gets thrown at Last of Us 2 is that the story feels downright hypocritical with its themes. Ellie is constantly beaten down and demonized for her quest for vengeance, while Abby is damn near rewarded for hers and treated like a hero. And it comes down to the inciting factor behind all of this. We all know why Abby wanted to kill Joel. The big twist, and I'm putting that massive air quotes, one of the most contrived ass pulls in gaming history. That scientist in the first game that wanted to kill Ellie for her delicious brain meat actually had a daughter, and she got really mad when Joel performed a completely justified act of self-defense on everybody in the hospital.
Please, I don't want to die.
I've seen guys speak to women with this much respect, and I deplore that. My mother is just totally, I grew up, my mother raised me, so I have this much respect for women and...
Now, Joel's decision at the end of Last of Us 1 is intentionally ambiguous on whether or not he was acting selfishly or as a loving parent. You're not really meant to have a concrete answer. It leaves that up to audience interpretation. There are clear logistical factors you can think about, such as how would a guerrilla terror group realistically create or mass produce a cure if theoretically one dose of the vaccine requires the death of the test subject? Or what is stopping the Fireflies from weaponizing the cure and using it to become a warlord faction just as violent and abusive as the government they're fighting? Or could you seriously think the Fireflies, already on the verge of extinction, would be able to defend themselves against a faction like the WLF, who are trained soldiers with significant power and resources? What would stop various factions in the country from just ganging up on the Fireflies and eliminating them, stealing the cure for themselves? Yeah, it's better to leave the cure as a hypothetical, just saying. But Last of Us 2 doesn't do this. It pretty much acts like what Joel did was completely evil, and he's a selfish asshole for doing it. Nothing else, no nuance. He's not even allowed to defend himself when Ellie freaks out and disowns him. He doesn't snap at her or even attempt to argue his own perspective, just that he did it and would do it again. Now, we as the audience know why Joel did it. He lost one daughter and refuses to lose another. And for Last of Us 1, this works perfectly. You've been playing as Joel pretty much the entire game. You've seen what he sees. All the carnage and violence he's had to perform is shit you, the player, had to experience.
Now, the girl. Is she alive?
What girl? I don't know no girl. Fuck!
Focus right here, right here. And I'll pop your goddamn knee off. The girl.
I argue that anybody that wants to truly condemn Joel over destroying the cure missed the point of the first game. Do you seriously think everything would just go back to normal if a cure was made? That all the bandits and cannibals would put their guns down and fix society? No. Joel decided that he didn't care about sacrificing Ellie for a cure because he didn't think it mattered. He spent 20 years experiencing the worst that humanity had to offer. He's seen the worst in people, and is pretty much burned out before he met Ellie. I always saw the ending of Last of Us 1 as a necessary evil. The question isn't sacrificing one person to get a cure right, it's more so asking if humanity even really deserved it if it meant costing Ellie, the one good person in the entire story. A cure means nothing if men like David are still running around. A cure doesn't make absolute psychopaths just suddenly stop. Hell, even the Fireflies were pretty shitty human beings themselves. They were violent terrorists that assassinated and bombed what's left of the military, who were protecting quarantine zones, and I highly doubt there was zero collateral damage in their attacks. The first game worked because there was no designated good guy. No faction was completely clean, and the story was unafraid of being open about it. The Fireflies come across more as desperate thugs than knights in shining armor, like how they do it in the sequel. In fact, the 180 spin they do with the Fireflies in 2 goes beyond just being a retcon. It feels downright cartoonish the way they try and paint over the fucked up shit they did. As in, you literally see Abby's father rescue a wounded zebra, and then monologue about how much he loves his friends, his job as a surgeon saving lives, and his daughter most of all. Boy howdy, it sure is great not having my carotid artery sliced open. I like having all my blood inside me just like I love my family. It's that transparent. They try so hard to sell Jerry, that is literally his name, as some saint that wants to save the world, but he comes across more as a short-sighted idiot more than anything. In fact, he's the one that pressures Marlene into okaying the surgery on Ellie. The callous cocksucker completely disregards Marlene's personal relationship with her, Joel's relationship with her, and the fact the girl is unconscious and not even an adult yet. Marlene essentially has to bitch smack him with, "Hey, what if it was your kid, asshole?" And he goes dead quiet. He never considered the ramifications of something like that until it affected him. Ellie was just a stranger he can use. How is this a good person?
She's a child. not some petri dish.
You think I don't... I'm aware of the situation.
And you're okay with killing her?
No, I'm okay with developing a vaccine that'll help save millions of lives. How many fireflies have died for less?
That was their choice. Are you asking me? Or are you telling me this is how it's gonna be?
I am begging you to buy in.
And what if this was Abby?
But wait! There's more!
I'm gonna go tell Joel.
Why?
He traveled across the country with her. He has a right to know.
Oh, he wants to make a cure and save mankind. Sure, but that doesn't immediately make a good person. The vibe I got from this and his cutscenes is that he's completely delusional. He sees himself as a savior and his arrogance bit him in the ass in the end. There was zero reason they couldn't wait until Ellie was awake and ask her true feelings on the matter, but Baby needed his glory now and basically caused all of this. This is absolutely not what they were going for though. They really want you to believe Jerry was the fucking Jesus of the apocalypse and he was the one man that could save mankind and Joel took that away. But all I got from this vibe is that he is a selfish, self-centered prick. So I don't feel bad that Joel killed him. Fuck this dude. Fuck this clown, and fuck his excruciatingly embarrassing death scene. They tried so hard to invoke the same weight that Sarah's death had. Abby is screaming and crying. Owen has to physically hold her back as she tries to rush to her dad, and I just feel annoyed. Sarah's death in Last of Us 1 worked because she was just a scared kid that had no clue what was going on. A complete innocent pulled into a hell on Earth. Joel and Sarah are set up as a typical family. Zero reason to dislike either of them. Sure, Joel is kind of a prick about not helping other families, but it was a completely chaotic situation. You can perfectly understand prioritizing your loved ones above all others. And Sarah was killed in such a cold manner. It just happens, and right when they thought they were saved. There's no buildup, it's matter of fact. People still get teary-eyed when they see Sarah's death scene. Throw Jerry's body in with the fucking pigs, who cares? He was a plot device, not a character. And his inclusion only worsens the issue with Last of Us 2's sense of morality. The main thing that set players off about this twist is that it's downright goofy. Jerry was completely randomized in the first game, but to make their cycle of violence message work, they retconned everything. Now he's got a daughter who's a special forces fighter man, and he was basically the Last of Us equivalent to Jesus about to cure the horrible zombie plague. This raises way too many crucial questions. If literally anyone can secretly have a relative about to declare vengeance on our protagonists, then why the fuck do you slaughter hundreds of people? As both Abby and Ellie, you'd think there would be an emphasis on non-lethal options if one of the major themes of your game is that violence begets more violence. Man, I sure do wonder if there was ever a game series that rewarded players for pacifist runs due to the creator's personal objections to war and violence. It sure would be embarrassing if somebody did your exact themes way better a full 20 fucking years earlier. Alright, I get it. You want to sell Ellie's arc of becoming a violent murder lady, so she kills a bunch of people. But this causes problems. In cutscenes, Ellie acts like a moody teenager completely unprepared to actually go on a revenge path. She's traumatized after beating Nora to death, yet you do considerably worse to all sorts of jabronis just minutes beforehand, including exploding people into meat with bombs, blowing their heads off with shotguns, stabbing their squishy throats with a switchblade. You get the idea. In fact, a very, very common praise for the game is that it lets you feel like a complete badass when you're playing as Ellie. Hey, if your specific message is that it's a bad thing to kill people, you probably shouldn't have people praising the fact that it's really, really fun to kill people. Just saying. But the thing with the cutscenes is that her suddenly being traumatized because this specific person dies basically admits that everyone else she kills doesn't matter. Murder is bad unless it's not in a cutscene. Then you get to go full John Wick. Once again, this whole problem could have been remedied by non-lethal options. You can sneak past or knock out the majority of enemies. So when you actually murder, it feels more substantial. That's simple. Almost like somebody did that already. And Abby's not exactly free and clear of this issue either. In fact, I'd argue it's substantially worse with her. See, Abby's arc isn't about losing herself to hatred and becoming a murderer. Instead, it's about finding someone to care about and seeing a light in the darkness. Seriously, you're just gonna do this again? Yeah, they blatantly just do the Joel Ellie thing with Abby and Lev. The difference being that Abby has a substantially worse character than Joel, and Lev is a potentially great character shackled by idiotic pandering that's a glorified marketing strategy. In fact, idiotic pandering is a theme here, but we'll get into that later. See, Abby's backstory is that she was a soldier for the Fireflies with her father, who acted as a surgeon for the group. After his death and the destruction of their group, because, you know, Joel killed Marlene, her and her friends joined the WLF, the Washington Liberation Front. Their nickname is the Wolves, but you'll have to cut my cock off before I ever call them that. And I'm not joking when I say the WLF are Army Man incarnate. There's some agonizing attempts at banter between the group. Everybody brags about how many enemies they kill, and they're so desperate to do their duty that they'll abandon things like self-preservation or basic common sense, all to look cool to an audience that's too busy skipping every line of dialogue so they can get back to shooting things. I mentioned this in a previous video, but the way the story treats the WLF is completely at odds with the themes. Violence is bad and only begets more violence, yet we're supposed to think Abby and her friends are cool for fighting this backwards cult. They outright confirm Abby has shot children and doesn't really care. And before you say, well, war is complicated, or her whole arc is about searching for redemption, then why don't we ever get a scene that directly throws Abby's sins back in her face? The same thing that the story does to Ellie constantly? Abby is never really ever forced to see what she's done and reflect on things. Instead, she comes across as a hollow attempt at the traumatized warrior trope. She says she feels guilty over things she's done, yet we never really find out what they are specifically, nor is it even really addressed. Even Last of Us 1 at least had that scene with Joel and Tommy, where you find out Tommy pretty much resents Joel for the shit he had to do to stay alive. It's vague, but it says more than enough to get to the point, especially when you add it together with all the things we've seen Joel do here, and then a little bit after. Also, the mere existence of the Seraphites completely pisses on the idea of morality being subjective. The cult tortures people, disembowels them, kills non-believers on sight, and never once is there even a sliver of nuance. Even David had more nuance. The literal cannibal pedophile had more nuance. And before you say, well, you have Yara and Lev, they ran away specifically because the cult was trying to kill them. The Seraphites are painted as an absolutely evil group with zero redeeming qualities. Do you see the problems here? You want to say that morality is subjective, yet are fine with demonizing a side and dehumanizing them if you think it would make your main characters look cool. In the words of a channel far better than my own.
When it comes to Abby, it's like, you think that she's a bad person for killing Joel? Everything is complicated, and it's like, but you're treating everything else like it's a black and white. The morality in this game is written by people who think that they could never be the bad guys. It shows.
I guess the way you can break the whole problem down is this. Last of Us 2 is an attempt at a dark story written by people that don't truly understand how to explore dark subject matter. Last of Us 2 thinks being dark is just having the protagonist grit their teeth and be miserable all the time. It's way more complicated than that, especially when the game specifically goes against the gritty tone to include things for the sake of pandering, such as having a heavily pregnant woman go into a combat zone. God, that shit is fucking stupid. Or how about having a random scene where a guy acts like an asshole to Ellie for the sake of having an epic bigot gets checked on his privilege scene. There's also the part where a Jewish girl compares a fictional zombie plague to the Holocaust, which was absolutely insufferable. Ellie and Dina's whole relationship was a complete joke anyway, but I'll talk about that later. And of course, you can't forget about Lev, the child soldier struggling with gender identity issues. I made a serious hot take in the last video I made about this series that Lev being transgender shatters the tone the game is shooting for because it requires the character to essentially be shielded from danger to get your point across. And yeah, I'm still sticking to that. Now, on paper, I really, really like Lev. I love me some Beasts of No Nations. I want a child soldier.
Are you ready to fight?
Yes, sir!
Are you ready to fight?
Yes, sir!
You wanna take that bridge?
Yes, sir!
We're gonna take that fucking bridge!
Yes, sir!
He been knocking. He been knocking. He been knocking.
This is something that's been driving me crazy about the game, though. Last of Us is about a very violent world, where objective survivalism takes priority above anything else. You do what you need to do to stay alive. Nothing more, nothing less. Remember in the first game when Henry wouldn't let Sam take a toy from a store they were hiding in? All because it was considered unnecessary, and they needed to save their backpacks for things like food or ammo. When the hierarchy of needs is thrown into chaos, the last thing on your mind is introspection. In fact, it's specifically because you're not thinking about what you're doing that you can survive, whether it be sneaking past enemy territory, killing another human being without hesitation, or even abandoning someone to die. Something like gender dysphoria just outright would not be on your list of priorities, especially especially if you know violating the norms of your group condemns you to death. Doing something like that just makes you look like a massive idiot. We're shoved in token for the sake of brownie points from journalists. This is just the reality of the situation. You will do what is necessary to stay alive, nothing else. It's Last of Us 2's greatest sin. It is desperate to be a gritty, realistic look at hatred and violence, but the writing is on par with the bullshit Disney pukes out. You want me to take this story seriously, but you constantly poke holes in the stage and expect me not to notice.
Your music's bad and you should feel bad.
A pregnant woman going into a combat zone is not just stupid, it's downright insulting to the audience's intelligence. Not even taking into account Mel's skills as a medic, which would mean her survival is key to the group's success. Every single military on the planet, regardless of nationality, emphasizes the idea of teamwork. One guy fucking up and being a liability can get the entire squad killed. A single screw-up leads to a snowball effect, and that can be the death of everyone involved. So why the fuck would anyone be okay with this heavily pregnant woman coming along for a dangerous mission? It's beyond idiotic, it's outright you thought we wouldn't notice. Any number of things can happen that incapacitates her or gets somebody else killed. You're shattering reality for the sake of fake drama and tension. Once again, that objective survival mindset is broken to manipulate feelings. There's way more examples than just this, but it's time to move on to the main point I've been wanting to make. Last of Us 2 doesn't want to truly address the wrong things Abby has done. As stated, they want to tease that Abby did some bad shit, but it's in the same way a cliche detective novel makes the protagonist an alcoholic. It's never meant to actually go anywhere, it's to make the protagonist look cool. There's never a scene where somebody smacks Abby across the face and call her out for what she did. Sure, you got the scene with Mel in the aquarium, but it just doesn't go hard enough. Last of Us 2 is desperate to make you like Abby, not just understand her, outright like her. So even though Mel does address Abby being a manipulative piece of shit that dragged her friends into danger over a vendetta, it has nowhere near the same impact as the scene with Joel and Tommy in the first game. That confrontation damn near turned into physical violence. Tommy even threatened to have him killed if he put his hands on him again. Mel in 2 basically goes, "You're a bad person," and Abby cries like a bitch. Then Yara immediately goes, "Oh, don't mind her, you're totally a great guy," to make her feel better, and then Yara dies. 2 wants to make the protagonist hard to sympathize with, but ironically, because it was so scared to just embrace Abby being a horrible person, it made her way less likable. People resented Abby because it felt like the story was pushing you to like her. From tearing down Ellie and Joel, making Abby's story about redemption and heroism, and giving her a two-dimensional bad guy to fight that makes her side look substantially better, until her side goes full psycho and tries to kill the two refugees she's protecting, which actually makes the 8-hour side quest you did to save one of them completely pointless, because she just gets capped without any ceremony. And this is right after Lev goes back to the island full of cultists that want him dead over his gender issues, so he can try to convince his mom to abandon the group, which obviously doesn't work because she was brainwashed for fucking years into believing this shit, and was apparently totally okay with the two of you getting tortured and executed in the first place. Yeah, this scene made me roll my eyes right out of my fucking head. Once again, you broke your tone for the sake of a powerful and emotional scene. Holy fucking shit, I hate this. I fucking hate it. Everything you do just keeps making things pointless and irritating, Neil. Now let's do what Abby doesn't do and think about how to get out of this situation without violence. Abby could easily play Yara and Lev off as two Randys that were captured by the Seraphites, who she just rescued and was coming to bring over to the good side, or Yara and Lev are deserters that are willing to give the WLF information in exchange for safety, or use her reputation as the top scar killer to give the two a pass. Basically fucking anything other than threatening your own guys with guns?
Fuck you!
Abby legit just starts shooting at her friends, all to protect two kids she's known less than a day. Why? Well, they saved her life. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention, when Abby ran into Joel back in Jackson, he saved her life from a horde of infected. So Abby treats being saved by Yara and Lev as some big character-defining moment that kicks off her redemption arc, yet gave no quarter to Joel, who did the exact same thing. How are you supposed to know that Yara didn't kill any dads? Or Lev? Lev killed Yara's mom, shouldn't that kick off some revenge path? Or is it because Yara didn't avenge her mom that she was shot to pieces? Whose dad is it okay to murder? I'm very confused right now. The WLF and the Seraphites have been at war for years. They've both seen the other side do a atrocious things to each other. Yet Abby's penchant for holding grudges goes out the window the minute the plot decides a redemption arc is in order. Meanwhile, the whole thing with her killing Joel is basically pointless beyond it kicking off Ellie's campaign. Abby never reflects on what she did to Joel. The closest thing you get to any of them showing any remorse is the scene with Owen, who shows clear signs of PTSD, and almost has that moment I talked about, where he and Abby almost get into a fucking screaming match over what she did to Joel, and that they're stuck in a cycle of conflict he wants out of. It was so close to something worthwhile. But then it turns into a completely out of place sex scene. I'm serious. They go from talking about trauma and guilt over their actions to a sex scene, an explicit sex scene. Hey, Sony, I thought you weren't cool with sex stuff in your video games. Oh, only if they're Japanese? Okay.
That's power, son.
I'm sorry, I really am, but this shit is horrible. It's just completely brain dead. Yet this is what's hailed as the toppest tier of video game writing. Why the fuck do I have to see a sex scene right after a discussion about PTSD? Why do I need to listen to two teenagers ramble about how they would rate their kiss? Video games can have better writing than the CW, I'm just saying. Play fucking Legacy of Kain. Do it. Neil, the lady that wrote those games was your boss. Fucking play it, Neil. Okay. Ellie and Dina, this was such a wasted opportunity that I'm shocked the usual suspects let this shit slide. Ellie and Dina's relationship can be summed up in a single sentence. Dina is a plot device. That's it. A literal plot device. She's just there to be the love interest. Dina really doesn't do anything in the story. She cracks jokes with Ellie, they talk about how much they're in love, and, they have sex, and... yeah. And when you find out she's pregnant, she devolves further into just a cheap source of drama. Oh, Ellie, we can't keep trying to get revenge. Dina is pregnant and we need a doctor. In any other context, any other, I swear to God, she would be blasted as a stale damsel in distress. But because she ticks the right boxes, it's magically okay. And it's frustrating, because Dina's presence in the story should have been blatantly obvious. She's the one that calls out Ellie for going too far. Dina is the moral center that Ellie pushes away in order to become more monstrous. But Dina never acts like this. The only time she gets anywhere close is the epilogue to the story, when she gives Ellie the ultimatum at the end. It comes out of nowhere, since Dina never voiced any hesitation or worries when they were in Seattle. She's just Ellie's girlfriend, that's her purpose. She's just there to give Ellie a love interest. It feels very sloppy and downright careless. So to put it simply, Last of Us 2 has a conflict with itself. Does it want to be a big budget Hollywood drama that sacrifices gritty realism for the sake of themes? Or does it want to be a grim exploration of the darkest parts of the human condition? It can't decide, and because of that, you have two conflicting philosophies that just emphasize the worst of each other. If it wants to be a fun, mindless action story, then you have way too many torture porn moments and attempts at making a point to be enjoyable. If it wants to be the video game equivalent to No Country for Old Men, there's too many concessions made to actively go against the tone it wants to set. It wants to show that morality is a matter of perspective, but the side they like are objectively the good guys. It's an obvious contradiction. Now, I don't want to just shit all over the game without offering some kind of suggestion on how to improve it. I'm not saying this is a guaranteed way to make the game a 10 out of 10, simply that it wouldn't cause the glaring issues with the story that stand out as hard as they do regularly. Before we do that, however, let's talk about a subject near and dear to my heart. Violent homicide!
Fuck you!
Last of Us 2 isn't just conflicted about showing Abby as a villain. It even really struggles to do this with Ellie. The character is specifically written to have a tragic downfall into evil. See, whenever Ellie has to confront one of the WLF members, she strangely has a hard time actually killing any of them. There's some kind of struggle or circumstance that turns it into, well, literal self-defense. There's really only one case where it's pure murder, and that was Nora in the Spore hallway, which even that turned into a completely unnecessary chase scene. And when I say unnecessary, I literally mean Ellie was halfway across the room, Nora says something that gets her mad, and Ellie for some reason tries to bash her in the head with the gun instead of shooting her from halfway across the room. Yeah. But even at the Spore hallway, that's negated because Ellie cries over caving the bitch's skull in with the pipe. The game seems like it's actively fighting the idea that Ellie's becoming a killer, even though in gameplay, as stated earlier, Ellie is absolutely cold-blooded. Hell, she was a killer in the first game. She pops all sorts of zombies and even human bandits and doesn't seem fazed by it. It feels like Ellie regretting what she's doing now is some arbitrary thing the story came up with. Once again, these people have a survival mindset. You kill if you have to kill and you don't think about it.
In this war, things get confused out there. Power, ideals, the old morality, and practical military necessity.
And if you want to say Ellie clearly softened up by her time in Jackson, no. This is the same excuse people have for why Joel couldn't spot the obvious trap Abby set up for him, and it's just as ridiculous when you consider what the game tells us. Joel and Ellie still go outside plenty of times. They both patrol the area around their settlement, which is still surrounded by infected and we can assume hostile bandits. Why would they ever soften their edge? Especially if they're still actively using their skill sets on a constant basis. That doesn't make sense. They still get into dangerous situations regularly. It's like saying the minute you go into a safe community, you just forget about your time at war. That's not how it works.
After all we've been through. Everything that I've done. It can't be for nothing.
So I've been sitting on an idea to sort of flesh out the whole cycle of violence theme, and fixing one of the more infamous moments in the game. Something that would require just a minimal amount of tweaking, and add a genuinely new perspective on the game's events. Three words. The theater scene. The theater scene is one of the most infamous sections of Last of Us 2. It's where you get the Armstrong fight, where everybody tried to intentionally fail it to see if you can get some special ending without Abby. It's also where the character of Jesse's killed off and subsequently forgotten about for the rest of the game. Plus Tommy's crippled, Dina gets the Fight Club experience, Ellie gets her ass kicked. You get the idea. Essentially, it's Abby and Lev styling on our protagonists for no other reason than Neil Druckmann going, "Abby is cooler, fuck you." Even though the events of the theater were what confirmed Abby being a gigantic piece of shit due to one simple word.
Good.
So I got to thinking about what this scene could actually represent, if it was handled right, and an idea popped up in my mind and just kinda stuck with me. This scene could have been a great way of subverting expectations in a really memorable way. You see, a great way of cementing the idea of everyone is the villain of their own story is by showing a literal mirror of events. The game opens with Abby capturing Joel and killing him, so for the climax of the story, it would be extremely fitting to see Abby suffer the same fate she put Ellie into. So for this to work, we only need to do a few tweaks to the story, not too many. If we were going to completely restructure the whole thing, that would take a long ass time, because boy howdy, this story has some problems. But for now, we're just going to do a few things for the sake of brevity and to make a point. So to change the theater scene, we need to adjust some of Ellie's segments, and by extension, Abby's. Instead of hunting down each member and killing them with Ellie, the idea would be that each time Ellie gets to their location, they would already be gone. We're led to believe they simply escaped. Ellie made too much noise, or showed up too late. The point is, she is denied her revenge. She's not a super assassin. At the same time, we're jumping back and forth between Ellie and Abby's perspectives, so we can be filled in on the importance of each character to Abby before hunting them down as Ellie. After you get finished checking your 3 points, thinking Ellie can't even get to Nora, she grows increasingly frustrated. This is where Ellie and Dina can butt heads. Dina is good-natured and doesn't like seeing Ellie become so ruthless and hateful. Ellie's filled with piss and vinegar, and she can't even take it out on the people she views as deserving it, so she keeps bottling it up, and her anger only spills out to the surface because she's not really thinking.
Because there's a conflict in every human heart between the rational and the irrational, between good and evil. And good does not always triumph. Sometimes the dark side overcomes what Lincoln called the better angels of our nature.
Wow! Fantastic! Very fantastic!
Well, this can lead to tension straining as you get to your last target, the aquarium. Here, it can play out relatively as normal, but with the added detail that Dina's been with you pretty much the entire time, and intentionally goes back to the theater on her own after getting into a violent argument with Ellie over her obsession. She's not sick or passes out. She is a constant premise challenging Ellie every step she takes. And by this point in the game, she makes the choice to leave Ellie by herself due to their fundamental disagreement over this whole thing. Other than that, you can still play it off pretty much the same. Ellie has to swim over there, the dog still dies, Ellie can still hold Mel and Owen up at gunpoint, but just as you think things are about to get violent, Tommy and Jesse show up. Ellie is completely taken back since she barely saw the two during her escapades. It's like they came out of nowhere or were there before she even arrived. Instead of dropping the map in a panic daze, Tommy specifically orders her to leave it on the ground. As it turns out, while Abby was using the aquarium as a safe haven for herself and her loved ones, Tommy and Jesse were watching her, and they take the time from when she was gone to go in and capture Owen and Mel alive. Ellie knows they've got something planned, but they don't let her in on all the details, simply that they were going to hold the two at the theater and wait for Abby. Cut back to the theater and you finally see what the two have been doing. While Ellie was running around trying to hunt the WLF members, Tommy and Jesse have been several steps ahead of her. They've been capturing the members of the WLF that were responsible for Joel's death. Admittedly, this is a creative liberty, since it wouldn't be easy to lug around numerous unconscious bodies through an absolute war zone. That's sort of why we don't see Tommy do it. All we know is that the WLF members went missing. They didn't directly die. Still, this is where Tommy gives Ellie an ultimatum. If she wanted in on what was about to go down, she needed to put away any emotion, any passion, anything that would distract her. This is the first sign that something bad was about to happen. Tommy isn't angry angry or even excited about what they were about to do. It's cold. Ellie tries to get on board, but Tommy immediately shoots her down. He can tell she's too impulsive. Instead, he simply tells her to watch Dina. He even offers that the two start making their way back to Jackson without them. Dina agrees, but Ellie needs to see this through to the end. Tommy hesitantly agrees to let the two stay, but he makes them swear to stay on the sidelines. Do not get involved. Ellie agrees, and this is where we jump to Abby showing up at the aquarium. This can play out pretty much the same as how it happened. Scar Island, Yara dying, the whole shebang. She enters the aquarium to find it empty and her dog bloodied and dead on the floor. She also sees the map directly leading her to the theater. Right now, Abby is also thinking impulsively, thinking Lev can even outright address that this feels like a trap. But Abby isn't listening. She's royally pissed off and worried about her friends. Well, when she enters the theater, it goes to all hell. Abby goes straight into a snare trap that knocks her unconscious, and Lev is disabled by Jesse, who bashes his head in with a fucking shotgun. The two are captured and chained up in the theater. There's no wriggling out of their restraints or even a way to move. They're completely immobilized. In front of them is a line of all the WLF members Abby took with her to Jackson. Manny, Owen, Nora, everybody. This sets her off immediately and she starts screaming. Ellie's watching, trying to fight the urge to just run up and shoot her in the head, but Tommy beats her to the punch. Tommy has Dina and Ellie watch as he talks to Abby, and he basically rubs everything they did in her face. How they hunted them down, how they captured everyone from right under their noses, and now they're all alone without a single friend to come and save them. Abby acts like Abby and starts screaming about how they're all dead and she let them live and they wasted it. Well, Tommy simply responds by kicking her in the ribs. See, what I'm going for here is essentially the idea that both Abby and Ellie pretend to be something they're not. They both want to be scary monsters, to be somebody willing to do horrendous things to people, but they both just aren't. Sure, they're capable of violence, but it's basically the same thing as a temper tantrum. They sought vengeance as an emotional response to vent out their feelings. They're kids playing at being adults. Well, Tommy and Jesse simply are what they are. There's a reason I keep mentioning Jesse in this hypothetical. It's because I really like the idea of Ellie seeing a very goofy, fun-loving version of the guy, only to be met with a very harsh reality when she sees him with Tommy. Because from here, it begins. Jesse goes down the line. And this is not fast or rushed. They take their time. Tommy absolutely torments Abby. He describes what it was like watching Sarah die all those years ago, seeing Joel as a dead, beaten, humiliated pulp. As all of this happens, it finally hits Ellie. It was never about her revenge. Tommy was in charge since the beginning, and nothing she did ever mattered. That's right, we're going full old boy, motherfuckers. It was never Ellie's revenge story. That's why Tommy left without her in the beginning of the game. It wasn't to protect her. It was because he wanted to settle the grudge. Jesse is just like the WLF members that helped Abby. He doesn't give a shit about their circumstances. He's just doing what he was told. This goes on for a while, each WLF member dying, until finally it gets to Mel and Owen. Now, I'm personally torn on whether or not they truly deserve to die. In this specific hypothetical where we've done our tweaks, we're going with a version of Mel that isn't a brain-dead retard that gets into gunfights with zero consideration to the fact she's pregnant. Instead, she's an angel on Owen's shoulder, trying to convince him to leave the WLF and run away. So Mel and Owen, in this hypothetical, would be trying to end their cycle of violence themselves. But they're caught up in Tommy's punishment because of Abby. The whole situation is intentionally played out like a nightmare. It's like Abby's personal hell came to life and swallowed her loved ones up along with her. So we're at an impasse here, story-wise. Do they deserve to die over their past sins catching up to them, despite trying to better themselves? Much like how Abby killed Joel despite his attempts to better himself? Or does Tommy let them go after they voice how much they despise Abby for what she made them do? Plus, Mel is pregnant, so this is either a true fall into darkness moment or a sign of forgiveness. I don't know. That's up in the air. Up to viewer interpretation, let's leave it at that. I can see it working both ways, personally. Point is, by the end, Abby is psychologically broken. Her exact fears came to life. She lost all her loved ones all over again, but this time it was undeniably her fault, and Tommy is not shy about voicing this. Obviously, he doesn't know who Abby's loved one was that Joel killed, but it's very clear he doesn't fucking care. And the scary part is that Tommy justifies all of this to himself. The way he sees it, somebody needed to be held accountable for Joel's death. If he didn't send a message to the WLF, they would see Jackson as weak. So he kept the message brief, yet brutal. If he can get to them, he can get to anybody.
Horror has a face. And you must make a friend of horror. Horror and moral terror are your friends. If they are not, then they are enemies to be feared. They are truly enemies.
From there, they leave Abby in the theater, still chained up and stuck staring at the corpses of her friends, much like how they left Ellie and Tommy for dead after murdering Joel. And just to insult them, Tommy leaves the key to their chains right in front of Abby's feet. Now, this would obviously affect the ending of the game. For one, the idea that Abby and Lev completely abandons everything to find what's left of the Fireflies would need a bit more fleshing out. Thinking you can have some sections where Lev basically goes, dude, what the fuck happened back there? And Abby has to explain what exactly she did to kick all this off. And you can even have an interesting dynamic where Lev also kind of rubs what Abby did in her face. Basically going, dude, this was your fault. You did this. The whole game has been about shitting on Ellie and saying she shouldn't look for revenge because it solves nothing. And now Abby gets her time in the spotlight as well. Because I'm thinking after this whole thing with the theater, obviously Abby would be looking for retribution over what happened. And Lev basically has to play common sense and tell her, if he can do that to you in your home territory, what the fuck do you think is gonna happen if you go to his? So they finally just say fuck it and try to go and move on. It might sound unsatisfying where, well, Tommy just did something extremely fucked up and evil, shouldn't he face some kind of repercussion for it? And the lesson is, Abby tried doing the exact same thing and look what it got her. It's actually addressing the fact that a cycle of violence needs to end if you want to end it. I'm still thinking they can get captured by the slavers, since that directly leads into Ellie's whole arc at the end here, because I'm thinking the events of the theater absolutely shakes Ellie and Dina as well. Their whole relationship is far colder than the Little House on the Prairie shit we got in the actual game. They're both trying to raise the baby Dina had from Jesse, but the guilt is eating them alive. Even Ellie understands that was beyond ugly, and this is where Jesse can come into play again, since he's still alive. Instead of Tommy showing up at the farmhouse, it's him. While he still seems relatively unaffected by what he did, you can see that he's trying to patch things up with Ellie. He wants to go back to being goofy buddy Jesse, but Ellie and Dina know who he truly is deep down. So, as essentially a Hail Mary to win back her friendship, Jesse tells Ellie about Abby's capture by the slavers. Dina wants to put the whole thing to rest and basically forces him out of the house, but Ellie can't stop thinking about it. She knows it's best to let sleeping dogs lie, but the theater taught her something. Ellie is not a monster. She's not capable of doing the things Tommy did or even Joel. She'll fight to stay alive, even kill, but she does not have the heart to be cruel, not like that. In the end, she's still Ellie, even after everything that's happened. Despite everything, even though she knows it needs to be basically put to rest, she still has some PTSD issues, but Ellie decides to track Abby down and rescue her, fully putting an end to everything. That's right, Ellie forgives Abby before she even goes to California. She doesn't go there to kill her, it's to save her. It can play out relatively the same. Ellie inspires a revolt, fights the slavers, finds Abby on her pole. She cuts both her and Lev down, and they all go down to the boats as usual. But just as they're about to go their separate ways, Ellie can notice that Abby is humming a song to herself, completely dazed from dehydration and exhaustion. Ellie impulsively makes a comment about how she likes the song, and the two can simply stare at each other. It goes quiet, and all you hear is the boat and the water, and they just crack smiles and sail off to their own uncertain futures. That's right, no fight at the end of the beach, they just walk away. From there, we can cut to Ellie playing guitar on her porch as the sun sets, flashing back to that last conversation with Joel where she says she's open to forgiving him. The final moments of the game are Ellie humming the song Abby sung to herself as she strums her guitar. You might not like this ending, but I feel like there was at least an attempt at clarifying the themes that the game wanted to explore. The twist of the story being that it was more of Tommy's revenge story than Ellie's fascinated me. It would recontextualize everything we've seen up to this point, and give a fitting punishment for both Ellie and Abby. They both realize they simply are not cut out to be the monsters they tried so hard to be. It doesn't solve every problem the game has, but I think this version of Last of Us 2 wouldn't be such a painful disaster like how the actual game ended up being. Basically, I wanted to try and add consistency to the morals. Abby is punished for her selfish actions, as is Ellie, but when they finally put aside everything and truly fight to change themselves for the better, they are rewarded. Ellie keeps her family, and gave two people a chance to find a sanctuary on their own. Abby definitely doesn't have fun, but in the end, her crucifixion is a symbolic show of her penance. She's suffered enough for what she's done. You still get the cold bite of Last of Us's world, but with that beacon of hope just underneath. Still, maybe I'm just crazy. This is already the internet equivalent to digging up old dinosaur bones, so I wouldn't be shocked if nobody really gives a shit. But this was fun. I had fun. Until next time, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. See you guys. Man, if I was being perfectly honest here, if I was going to rewrite Last of Us 2, there would be way more gay porn.
Hey, buddy, I think you got the wrong door. The leather club's two blocks down.
Fuck you.
I'll show you who's boss in this gym.